Question number 95, and this question says a disk has 200 tracks numbered from 0 to 199. At a given time, it was servicing the request of reading data from track number 120, and at the previous request, service was for the track number 90. The pending requests are given like this. These are the track numbers for the request 30, 70, 115, and then 130, 110, 80, 20, and 25. How many times will the head change its direction? Okay, this is important. How many times head will change its direction? So it is not asking about the head movements. It is simply asking about the head change of its direction. Head change means whenever the head is moving to left direction, let's say head was moving to this direction, and now it has to change its direction to service a request in the left hand side. So this is the head movement. Okay, so there's a head movement whenever we are serving the request in one direction, and then we have to change the direction to go to the left side or go to the right side. For the disk scheduling policies, SSTF and FCFS. So we have to find the number of head change its direction in case of SSTF and in case of FCFS. So let's say we have track numbers from 0 to 199 and heads are numbered like this, let's say 25, 50. So these are the track numbers. So first, if I use SSTF, in case of SSTF, I'm currently at the location 120. Okay, my head is at the 120 location. Let's say this is 120, and currently I'm here. So which of these requests are near to me? Okay, we have 115, 110, and 130. So nearest request is 115. So first I will serve the request 115, which is because this is giving the shortest seek time. Okay, so I will take the request which is giving shortest seek time. So 115 is giving shortest seek time, that is of 5. Okay, 5, shortest seek time of 5. So this is the head move, and this is the head change its direction. Okay, head is changing its direction. How I can say that head is changing its direction? Because service was for the track number 90. Okay, previous request was 90, then after 90 it moved to 120, which means head was moving in this direction, okay, in the right direction. So now it have to change the direction. So initially it will change the direction, then after 115 we will access 110. Okay, after 110 we have two options, 130 and 80. So to go 80 we require 30 seek time, and for 110 and for 130 we require 20. So we will go to 130. Okay, so after 130 we have two options, this is done, we have 80 and then 70. So we have to change the direction to go to the 80. Okay, so first we will go to 80, then we will go to 70. After 70 we will serve the request, we have 20, 25 and 30. So first we will access the 30 because 30 is nearest to 70, then 25. Okay, 30 will be somewhere here, then 25 and then 20. So how many head movement? This is first head movement. Initially this is the head movement because head is moving its direction from right side to left side. Then there is a second head movement because it was moving to left side, now it have to move to the right side. So this is a head change. Okay, now this is third head change. It was moving to right side, but now it have to move to the left side. So there are three head changes in this case of SSTF. Okay, so let's see in case of FCFS. So we have track number from 0 to 199, and let's say we have 25 50 75 100. So initially head is at the direction 120. From 120 first we have to go to 30 because we are using the algorithm, that is FCFS, first come first serve. So we will go to 30, and 30 will be somewhere here. So there's a head movement because head was moving in this direction, the right direction, because due to this 90. So after 30 we will go to 70, and 70 is in this direction. That means now we will go to this direction there is a head movement. Okay, there is a head movement because we were moving to right left side. Now we are moving to right side. Then after 70 we have to go to 115. After 115 we have to go to 130. Then after 130 we have to come back for 110. Okay, there is a head movement, that is 110. So this is a head movement. This is head movement, head changing its direction. After 110 we will go to 80. Okay, after 80 we have to go to 20. So 20 will be somewhere at this direction. After 20 we have to go to 25. So 25 will have to move to right side. So this is 25. So how many times in case of FCFS it is changing direction? First direction change is this one, right to left. Then I was moving to left hand side, I have to move direction to the right side. So this is second head movement, this is my third head movement, and this is fourth head movement. In case of FCFS it will be four head movements. In case of SSTF there will be three head movements. So answer is 3, 4, that is C. Then we have question number 97. Question number 97 says, a system has n resources numbered from R0 to Rn-1 and then k processes numbered from P0 to Pk-1. The implementation of the resource request logic, which means processes are requesting the resources using this code. Okay, each process Pi is as follows. If process number is divisible by 2, that means if the process is odd even numbered, then it will access the resource Ri and Ri plus 2. If the process is request number odd, that means if it is not even, then it will access from the backside, that is Rn minus I and Rn minus I minus 2. This is R minus I minus 2 and this is Rn minus I, which means they will access from the backside. So if we have processes, that is even numbered resources, if we have even numbered resources, in this case what will happen is even number of process will access the even resources and odd numbered process will access the odd processes. How? If I have let's say in this case I have n equals to 40 and k equals to 26, there will not be any problem because the number of resources are even. What we can do is even numbered resources will be given to even numbered process and the odd numbered process, odd numbered resources will be given to odd numbered process. How? Let's say P0. P0 will require the resources R0 and then I plus 2, that is R2. Like this, P1, that is odd numbered process, will access the resource, that is Rn minus I, that is n is 40 and I is 1, that means 39 and 37, R minus R into n minus I minus 2. Process P2 will require the resources, that is R2 and R4. Process P3 will require the resource, that is Rn minus I, n minus n is 40 and I is 3, that is 37, and then R minus n minus I minus 2, that is 35. Like this they will access the resources, and last even number process will be P26 because we have number of processes 26 and it will require to access R26 and R28. And last odd numbered process will be P25 and it will require to access R40 minus I. N minus I means 40 minus 25, that is 15, and then So like this, even numbered processes will access the resources like this and odd numbered processes will access the resources like this. So there will not be conflict in even numbered process, in even numbered resources and odd numbered resources. So there will not be dependency between processes. So P0 can start executing with R0, R2 and can after releasing these resources, P2 can start. Like this, all the processes can start the execution. So there is no deadlock. There is no problem with deadlock in case of A and C because C will be same. Because we have even number of resources, so it will be also be like this. Even numbered process will access the even numbered resources and odd numbered process will access the odd numbered resources. So we can have problems with B and D. So let's look at the B. B saying n equals to 21 and k equals to 12. So in this case, P0 will access the resources P0 and R0 and R2. P1 will require to access the resources, that is n minus i. Okay, n minus 1 means 20, and n minus i minus 2, that is R18. So P2 will access the resources R2 and R4. P3 will access the resources R18 and R16. Like this, P4 will access the resources P4 will access the resources, that is R4 and R6. P5 will access the resources R16 and R14. Like this, P6 will access the resources R6 and R8. So P7 will access the resources R14 and R12. P8 will require to access R8 and R10. And P9 will require to access R12 and R10. Now there is a problem. P10 will access the resources R10 and R12. P11 will require to access n minus i, that means n is 21 and I is 11. 21 minus 11, that is R10 and R8. P12 will require to access the resources R12 and R14. And now let's look at the dependencies. So if you look at the P8, P8 requires R8, R10, P11 requires R10 and R8. So in this case, P8 is waiting for P11 and P11 is waiting for P8. How? Let's say this P8 and P11 are executing parallelly. So in first line of resources, P8 will be given R8 and P11 will be given R10. Okay, so now P8 is waiting for P11 to release R10 and P8 is waiting for P11 to release R10. So there is a cycle in these two resources. And due to this cycle, there is a deadlock between these processes. So this will result in a complete deadlock. Okay, so according to this, option B is not suitable and this combination is dangerous for the system. There will be a deadlock in this case. Question number 98. A system contains 3 programs and each requires 3 tape units for its operation. The minimum number of tape units which the system must have such that deadlock never arises. So we have 3 processes, or you can say 3 programs, and each program requires maximum requirement is 3. So how many resources should be there to prevent the deadlock? So let's say we have 3 processes P1, P2, P3. What we can do is, to find the minimum number of resources required such that there is no deadlock, we can give n-1 resources to this, n-1 resources to this, and after giving n-1 resources to this, we have one more resource. That means we have to give n resources to last process so that it can proceed, and after executing the process, it can release the resources. So let's say n is the maximum requirement of a process. So n is 3 here. So we will give 2 resources to P1, 2 to P2, and we require 3 resources now to give to P3 so that P3 can start executing. So if you take 6, there will be a deadlock. We will give 2, 2, 2, and they cannot proceed. So if we have 7 resources, we can prevent the deadlock like this. Okay, so B is the right answer for this question. Question number 99 says, which of the following standard algorithms is not a dynamic based algorithm, is not a dynamic programming based algorithm? So Bellman-Ford short algorithm for single shortest path is a dynamic algorithm. This is dynamic based algorithm, dynamic programming based algorithm. B is Flood-Warshall. We know that this is all pair shortest path and this is definitely a dynamic algorithm. Then we have 01 knapsack and this is dynamic approach. Okay, so we have 2 versions of knapsack problem, that is 01 knapsack and fractional knapsack. Fractional knapsack is greedy approach and 01 knapsack problem is dynamic programming approach. Prim's algorithm for spanning trees greedy approach. This is not a dynamic programming approach. So D is the right answer for this question. Question number 101. This question says we have four matrices M1, M2, M3 and M4 of dimensions P into Q of M1, Q into R of M2, R into S for M3 and S into T for M4 respectively can be multiplied in several ways with different number of total scalar multiplications. For example, we can multiply M1, M2, then M3, M4. The total number of multiplications is PQR and RST and PRT. When multiplied as M1, M2 and M3, then M4, the total number of scalar multiplications are these. So P is given 10, the dimension of M1 is 10 into 100. Okay, this is the dimension 10 into 100. Then for matrix M2, we have 100 into 20. Then matrix for R3, we have 20 into 5. Then for M4, we have 5 into 80. So we have these dimensions and we have to calculate the total number of scalar multiplication needed. So we can solve this problem using the dynamic programming approach for matrix multiplication to find the number of scalar multiplications. So we can find using dynamic programming algorithm. So dynamic programming says if you want to multiply Mij, okay, you want to multiply this number of matrices, then if Mij i equals to j, that means if there is a 11, M11 or M22, M33, then this will be 0 number of multiplications. Otherwise, minimum of Mik plus M k plus 1 j plus p I minus 1 p k and p j. In this case, k is from I to j. Okay, k is always less than j and it can be equal to I. So value of k will vary like this. So we will find the minimum of all these values of k. Okay, so we want to find the for m14. So for M14, the equation will be like this, minimum of, and k will go from 1 to 4, okay, the value of k will be less than 4. So first is Mik, that means let's take k equals to 1 first, M11, I is 1 and k is 1 plus k plus 1, that is 1 plus 1 is 2, M24 plus pi minus 1. Pi minus 1 means we will see what is P. So I is 1, Pi minus 1 will be P0, then Pk that is 1 and Pj that is 4. So then M will be K, we will take the value of K that is 2. M12 plus K plus 1, K is 2, K plus 1 will be 3 plus I will be same, K will change and 4. Then let's take the value of k 3, because value of k can go from 1 to 3 plus k is 3, k plus 1 will be 4 and this is j plus p0 p3 that is k and p4. So this will be the final number of multiplications required. So we'll take the minimum of these requirements. So we can calculate these values directly, M11, M12, M34, M44, but we cannot calculate M24 and M13 directly. So we have to find the equation for these two also. So let's see how we can find the equations for these. So for M13, it will be minimum of, and k can go from 1 to 2 because less than 3. So M11 plus k plus 1, that is M23 plus P0, P1 and P3. Then we will take the value of k, that is 2. M12 plus M33, because the value of k is 2 and k plus 1 will be 3 plus p0, p2 and p3. So we will have to take the minimum of these two. And the m24, we have to calculate m24 also. Equation for m24 will be like this, minimum of, and k can be from 2 to 4. That means the value of k can be 2 and 3. minimum of M24, okay, M22, the value of I is 2 and the value of K is 2, plus M34 plus I is, that is PI minus 1. PI minus 1 means P1. I is 1, so PI minus 1 will be P1. I is 2 and J is 4, so I minus 1 will be P1. Then P2 and P4. Now I will take the value of K, that is 3. So M23 plus M44, because K plus 1 will be 4, plus P1, P3 and P4. So this will be the equation for M24. To calculate this equation, to calculate M14, I require M24 and M13. 11 will be 0 and this values, okay, what is P0? So we have dimensions like this, P into Q, then Q into R, then R into S, and then S into T. So dimensions are given like this, 10 into 100, then 100 into 20, after that 20 into 5, and 5 into 80. So the values of P are like this, this is P0, okay, 10 is P0, this is P1, this is P2, this is P3, and this is 80 is P4, like this. So the value of P0 is equals to 10, the value of P1 equals to 100, the value of P2 equals to 20, the value of P3 is 5, and the value of P4 is 80. So now we can put the values and find the answers. Let's see what will be M24. So M24 will be the minimum of these values. So M22 is 0 because I equals to J, so this will be 0. M34 means you are multiplying these two matrices, 3, 4. Okay, so 20 into 5 into 80. The cost of multiplication of these two matrices will be 2 into 5 into 80, plus P1 into P2 into P4, that is P1, P2, P4. So 20 into 80 into 100. Okay, then M23. M23 is the multiplication of these two, and the cost of multiplication of these two is 100 into 20 into 5. Okay, 100 into 20 into 5, plus M44 is 0, plus P1, P3, P4, that is P1 is 100, P3 is 5, and P4 is 80. So if you look at the values, minimum of 0 plus this will be 8k, or you can say 8000. Okay, this will be 160,000. 80 into 2 is 160, then 0 and 100, that will be 1000. So 160k, or you can say 160,000. This will be 10,000, plus this will be 40,000. Okay, so the values will be like this. This will be 160,000 plus 8,000, that is 168,000, and this will be 50,000. So minimum of these two is, the value of M24 will be 50,000. Okay, so now I have the value of M24. Now I need to calculate the value of 13. So M13 will be like this, minimum of all these values. Okay, M11 is 0, M23 is M23, these two matrices are 100 into 20 into 5, plus P0, P1, P3, that is 10 into 100 into 5. Then we have M12. M12 is this, 10 into 100 into 20. Then M33 is 0, plus P0, P2, P3, that is 10 into 20 into 3, that is 5. So the minimum of these two will be, this will be 10,000 plus 5,000. Okay, 10,000 plus 5,000 is 15k. This will be 20 into 1,000, that is 20,000, plus this will be 1000. So this will be 21,000, and this is 15k. Minimum of 15k and 20k is 15k. So the value of 13 is 15k and the value of M24 is 50k. Now we have to put all these values to M24. Okay, we have to put all the values to here in this equation M14. Final equation is M14. So let's see how we can do this. So we have calculated the value of M24, that is 50k, and we have calculated the value of 13, that is 15k, or you can say 15,000. Okay, so now we have to put all the values to this. So M14 will be minimum of all these values, that is M11 is 0, M24 is 50,000, P0, P1, P4, that means P0 is 10, P1 is 100 and P4 is 80. Now second one is M12. M12 is this, the cost of multiplication is 10 into 100 into 20. So 10 into 100 into 20 plus M34. 34 is this, 20 into 5 into 80. Plus P0, P2, P4, that is 10 into 20 into 80. Then we have M13, which we have calculated, that is 15,000. Plus M44, that is 0. Plus P0, P3, P4. P0 is 10. P3 is 5. And P4 is 80. Okay, let's see what is minimum of these. Minimum of these will be answer. So 50,000 plus 80,000. Okay. So 50,000 plus 80,000. First one. Second one is 20,000 plus 8,000 plus 16,000. This will be 15,000 plus 4,000. Minimum of this will be answer. So this is simply 50,000 plus 80,000 is 130,000. This will be 20 plus 8 plus 16, that is 16 plus 8 is 24, and 44,000. This will be simply 19,000. So the minimum of all these three is minimum of 130k, 44k and 19k is simply 19,000 or 19k. So this will be the answer for this question. M14, the cost of multiplication of M14 will be 19,000. Question number 102. This question says, be a graph with n vertices and m edges. What is the tightest upper bound on the running time of DFS of G? Assume that the graph is represented using the adjacency matrix. Okay, adjacency matrix. So if we represent the graph using the adjacency list, using adjacency list, DFS takes order of m plus n. But if you use the using adjacency matrix, in this case it requires order of n square time. Okay, so we have represented the graph using adjacency matrix, so C is the right answer. Question number 103. This question says, which one of the following is a key factor for referring B-tree over binary search tree for indexing database relations? Always remember, binary search tree can store only one key inside a single node, which means binary search trees can be used to store the data in the main memory. Okay, so always binary search tree is used to store the data in the main memory, and B-trees are used to store the data in disk. Okay, so disk can store more than one keys in a single node, and we know that in a single hard disk block we store more than one keys, or you can say we store more than one records in a single block. So what we can do is we can make the block size equals to node size, which means that we can the disk transfer will become easy. We can transfer the complete record from a single block. Okay, if you access the hard disk, you will access the single block at a time. So you can access one block, and in one access you can access the all the records inside that block. So options are saying database relations have a large number of records. It does not have to do anything with BST or B-tree. Database relations are stored on the primary key. This is not relevant. B-trees requires less memory than binary search trees. Okay, this is true, but this is not the reason we use B-trees over binary search trees for storing the indexing in the B-trees. So data transfer from disk is in the blocks. This is the reason we use B-trees to store the indexes. Indexes are stored in the disk. When we want to access any record, we bring the indexes from hard disk to main memory, because the data transfer between memory and disk is in the form of blocks. So we will use B-trees, because B-tree node can store one block in one node. So it will make the IO operations less costly. So D is the right answer for this question. Question number 104 says the cyclomatic complexity of each of the module A and B shown below is 10. So cyclomatic complexity of A, cyclomatic complexity of B is 10. What is the cyclomatic complexity of the sequential integration shown in this diagram on the right hand side? So we are integrating these two modules. Then what will be the cyclomatic complexity after integration of these two modules? Okay, we know that cyclomatic complexity is nothing but is a software matrix used to indicate the complexity of a program. We use cyclomatic complexity as a metric for measurement. Okay, this metric is used to find the complexity of a program. Cyclomatic complexity is nothing but it is computed using the flow graphs. Okay, control flow graphs. We make the control flow graphs from the program. Okay, if we have any if else or for loops in a program, so we actually make the control flow graph using the conditional statements in the program. So from those conditional statements we make a graph, and from that graph we try to find out the number of nodes and number of edges. Then from the number of nodes and number of edges we can calculate the cyclomatic complexity. But nothing like that is given in the question. We are given only the cyclomatic complexities. So we can say that cyclomatic complexity is nothing but number of decision paths minus number of decision paths plus 1. Okay, this is the cyclomatic complexity of any module. So in this case the cyclomatic complexity of A is given, that is 10, and cyclomatic complexity of B is 10. When you integrate these two modules, what will be the cyclomatic complexity of this module? So cyclomatic complexity is given, number of decision path we can calculate from this. For A, number of decision paths will be 9. Okay, number of decision paths in A will be 9, and same as this, number of decision paths in B will also be 9. So cyclomatic complexity of this will be the number of decision paths in A, number of decision paths in B, because this is followed by B is followed by A. So number of decision paths in A plus number of decision paths in B plus 1. Okay, plus 1. So number of decision paths will be, for this module, number of decision paths in A plus number of decision paths in B plus 1. Okay, this one. So cyclomatic complexity will be 9 plus 9 plus 1, that is 19, after integration of these two modules. So the right answer for this question is A, that is 19. Question number 107 says, what is the maximum number of reduce moves that can be taken by a bottom-up parser for a grammar with no epsilon and unit productions? Epsilon production means null production and unit production of this type. To parse a string with n tokens. So we have n tokens. N tokens means the length of the string is n. For example, if I have AABB and we have productions like this, A tends to BC, and let's say B tends to A, and C tends to BB. So if you want to reduce this production, this string to this starting symbol in bottom-up parsing, what we do is we try to reach the starting symbol from the string by doing some reductions. So we will make the reductions like this. We will scan the string from left to right. We will make a rightmost derivation in the reverse order for the bottom up parsing. So rightmost derivation will be done like this. We will reduce AA to C, BB to C, then we will reduce AA to B, then we will reduce to A. Like these three reductions will be required, or you can see like this, A tends to BC. This is first reduction, then B tends to A, C, then AA, B. So this is second reduction, this is third reduction. In case of, if the length of string is 4, you require 3 reductions. So if the length of the string is n, you require n minus 1 reductions. So answer for this question is B. Question number 11. A company needs to develop a strategy for software product development for which it has a choice of two programming languages, L1 and L2. The number of lines of code developed using L2 is estimated to be twice the line of codes developed with L1. So the product will have to be maintained for 5 years. Various parameters for the company are given in the below. So man year needed for development means LOC divided by 10,000, which means man years. Man years means we require the line, let's say line of code are x by 10,000 man years to develop this much of code. Development cost per man year is 10,000, let's say 10 lakhs. Okay, per man will require 10 lakhs to develop this much of code. Okay, and for L2 it is this. Maintenance time is 5 years. For 5 years, the cost of maintenance per year is 1000. Total cost of the project includes cost of development and maintenance. What is the LOC for L1? For which the cost of the project using L1 is equal to the cost of the project using L2. So first let's assume line of code in L1 equals to X. Okay. Then in L2, the line of code developed using L2 is estimated to be twice of the L1. So in case of line of codes for L2 will be 2x. Okay, so this will be the line of codes. So if you want to calculate the number of people required to develop this code in case of L1, it will be x, line of code is x divided by 10,000. This much of man year required, this much of man years required. And for each man per year, we have a cost of 10 lakhs in case of language L1. Okay, this is the cost plus maintenance for 5 years, because the cost of development and maintenance project in the cost of project includes cost of development. This is the cost of development. We require X by 10,000 people for 1 year, and multiplication by each person 1 year will be the cost of 10 lakhs. Then plus maintenance, we will maintain the project for 5 years, and for 1 year the maintenance cost is 1 lakh. Okay, so this is for L1, and for L2 it is line of codes is 2x in case of L2 divided by 10,000. This much of mans per year will be required, and the cost of each man per year is in this case 7,50,000 in L2, in strategy L2. Plus we have to maintain the project for 5 years, and the for 1 year the cost of maintenance per year is 50,000. So you can solve this equation and you will find that x equals to 5,000. The value of x will be 5,000 after solving this equation. So the answer to this question is B. Question number 113. This question says, which one of the following is not desired in a good software requirement specification document? Software requirement specification document is a document which is prepared in the first stage of development, in which we gather all the requirements from the user and document them properly. The requirements can be from the user side and can be from the development side. So in SRS document, we include all kind of requirements like functional requirements, goal, non-functional requirements, user requirements, and developer requirements. All kind of requirements are documented in a single SRS document. And SRS document is one of the important document of complete development process because all the designs and coding are done on the basis of SRS document. And also SRS document works as an agreement between client and developers. So SRS document definitely include functional requirement and non-functional requirements and goals of implementation. But algorithm for software implementation is not specified in SRS document. This is specified in the design document. Okay. So this is the right answer. This is not a desired thing to include in the software requirement specification document. So this is the right answer for this question. Question number 104 says, in a complete KRE tree, every internal node has exactly k children. Okay. Complete KRE tree, which means all the nodes will be filled till the last level. All the nodes will be filled. The number of leaves in such a tree with n internal nodes is what? For example, let's say k equals to 2. So this tree becomes binary tree. Exactly k children. If k equals to 2, we have 2 children, which means this is binary tree. So in case of binary tree, you can try to find the number of leaf nodes using the internal nodes and the value of k. Internal nodes in this case is 3. We have 3 internal nodes in this tree and we have 4 leaves. Okay, leaf nodes are 4. So how k and n are giving the number of leaf nodes? So if we apply nk, this means nk will be 6, but our l is 4. If I apply this one, n minus 1 to the power k plus 1, that is 2 to the power 3, this will be 8. If I apply this nk minus 1 plus 1, this will be 3 into k minus 1 is 1 plus 1, this is 4. Okay, this is okay. So let's try with more options. Let's say I am adding more children to this. Now number of leaf nodes are 8. Number of internal nodes are 3 plus 4, 7. Now relation becomes like this and k equals to 2. Okay, let's try to find the value using n and k. So in this case n is 7, okay, k is 2, so 2 minus 1 is 1 plus 1, that is 8. So option 3 is giving good values. So let's say k equals to 3. Let's say we have a 3 array tree in which we have each node will have 3 children. Okay, this is true for binary tree. Okay, for binary tree it is true. Let's see if it is true for k equals to 3 or not. So number of internal nodes in this case are 4. We have 4 internal nodes, that is 1, 2, 3, 4. And number of leaf nodes are 9. And the k value is 3. So let's see, is this holding for the k array tree? N is 4, k is 3. So k minus 1 become 2 plus 1. So this is 4 into 2 plus 1, that is 9. Okay, so this is holding for all values. So number of leaves in a complete KRE tree will be n into k minus 1 plus 1. Question number 115. Suppose that tn equals to 2t n minus 2t n by 2 plus n, and t1 is given as 1. So we can which of the following is false? Okay, which of the following is false? So we can solve the recurrence relation using the Master's theorem. In this case, first we need to find out the k equals to log ba. Okay, so log 2 2 is 1, n to the power k will be n to the power 1, that is n. So now we compare fn and n to the power k. When you compare n to the power k and fn, that is n, they are equal. So we can apply the second case of Master's theorem. Second case says, the complexity of this will be tn equals to order of n to the power k log n, or you can say order of n log n. Okay, n log n. So phi n square, this is saying it will take at least n square time. In best case it will take n square, but we have found that in worst case it will take order of n log n. So this is true, this is true, this is also true. Order of n square is also true for n log n. It can be order of n square, n cube, like this. But this is saying this will take minimum n square time. Okay, this is the best case. In best case, it will take error of n square, but as we have seen, in worst case, it will take n log n. So it cannot take in best case n square. So this is false. Question number 116. The part of machine level instruction which tells the central processor what has to be done. So in any instruction, we have two parts. Okay. So if the format of instruction is like this, we have two parts. That is opcode. In an instruction, we have an opcode and then we have an operand. So opcode is like this: add, subtract, multiplication, like this. This opcode, or you can say operation code, tells the processor what has to be done. We need to add the operands, or we need to subtract the operands, or we need to multiply the operands. So while we decode the instruction, while we decode the instructions, we try to find out what is the opcode. Okay, what we want to do. So opcode, or you can say operation code, tells the processor what need to be done. So option A is correct for this question. Question number 117, and this question says a system program that combines two separately compiled modules of a program into a form suitable for execution. Which of the following system program link two modules of a program? For example, let's say, what is the compilation process of a program for a source code? If we have a source code, for example, abc.c, we send it for the compilation. In first phase, what we do is we do the pre-processing. Okay, so in this pre-processing, we do not do anything like linking. We only expand the macros. Then after getting the pure high level language code, what we do is we do the compilation. Okay, after compilation, we get a code, that is, let's say abc.asm. And then we send this code. This is assembly language code. So we send this to assembler. And assembler give us abc.o, that is object code. So after getting the object code, what we do is we send this to linker, and linker links all the libraries. It can be dynamic library, or it can be compile time library, or you can say static library. So all the library functions are linked to the program in this phase, that is linking. So in linking, what we do is we take all the functions which we have used, like printf, in our program. So this linker will link all the library functions to our program during this stage, that is linking. So after linking, finally we have a code, that is executable code. You can load this code and start executing. So linker link all the object code of a program. Question number 118. This question says, what is the meaning of bug? Okay, bug means a logical error in a program, a difficult syntax error in a program, documenting program using an efficient documentation tool, or all of the above. So logical error is nothing but a bug, nothing but bug is only found at after the running of a program. You cannot find the bug before running a program. So if you are finding anything after running a program, that is a logical error, not a syntax error, because you cannot run a program with the syntax error. So a bug is a logical error in a program. Question number 119. This question said, let L be a language and LDES will be the complement of this language. Which of the following is not a viable possibility? Neither L nor L complement is recursive enumerable. This is possible. Okay, let's say a language is not a recursive enumerable, then the complement will also not be recursively enumerable languages. So we have the languages like this. This is the set of all kind of languages, let's say 2 to the power sigma star. Then we have all some languages inside this set, that is recursively enumerable. Then inside this we have languages which are only recursive but not recursively enumerable. These languages are recursively enumerable but not recursive. Okay, then we have CFLs, and then we have regular languages. This is the hierarchy of languages. So if a language is existing here which is not, this language is not recursively enumerable, then this is definitely not recursive. The complement of this language will also not be recursively enumerable. So this is okay. one of L and L complement is recursive but not recursive. One of L and L complement is recursively enumerable but not recursive. The other is not recursively enumerable. It is possible. Let's say L is recursively enumerable but not recursive. But not recursive. The other is not recursively enumerable. This is true. One language L and the other language will be complement. And we know that complement of recursively enumerable language is not recursively enumerable. So this is true. If a language is recursively enumerable, then the complement of this language is not recursively enumerable. Both L and L complement are recursively enumerable but not recursive. This is not possible. A language L which is recursively enumerable, the complement of this language cannot be a recursively enumerable language. Okay, recursively enumerable languages are not closed under the complement operation. So the complement of a recursively enumerable language is not recursively enumerable. D is saying both L and N complements are recursive. This is true. The complement of a recursive language is recursive. So C is not possible. C is the right answer for this question. Question number 120, and this question says let L1 be a recursive language. Okay, we have a language L1 that is recursive, and then we have L2 language that is recursively enumerable but not recursive. Okay, but not recursive. Which one of the following is true? The complement of L1 is recursive and the complement of L2 is recursively enumerable. This is not possible. This line is okay. The complement of recursive can be recursive, but the complement of recursively enumerable is not recursively enumerable. The complement of L1 is recursive and the complement of L2 is not recursively enumerable language. This is true. Okay, this is true. The complement of L1 is recursive and the complement of L2 that is recursively enumerable language is not recursively enumerable. This is true. The complement of L1 and L2 are recursively enumerable. This is not true. Okay. The complement of L1 is definitely a recursively enumerable because L1 is recursive. Then the complement of L1 is also recursive. So all the recursive languages are also recursively enumerable languages. But L2 complement cannot be recursively enumerable language. Okay. D is saying complement of L1 is recursively enumerable and L2 complement is recursive. This is not possible. Okay. Is this possible? The complement of L1 is recursive. Okay, this is true. The complement of L1 is recursively enumerable because the complement of L1 is recursive and it is also recursively enumerable. And the complement of L2 is recursive. This is not possible. L2 complement is not recursively enumerable, so it cannot be recursive. So answer to this question is B.